Wake up, everybody, no more sleeping in bed. No more back to thinking, time for thinking ahead. The world has changed so very much.
Welcome, Soul Star Live. Live from the basement of the Phoenix Center for the Arts in the Radio Phoenix Studios. I'm your host, Calvin Worthen, here with a very, very special guest of mine. Very honored to have had this opportunity here in 2020 during the pandemic of pandemics to have a good conversation with the historian and well-known lector, founder of Diamond Strategies, LLC, and also the owner of the Whitaker Group. It is Dr. Matthew Whitaker. Thank you so much for coming on the Soul Star Live. Good brother, how you doing?
It's a pleasure to be here with you. I'm good. Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
That's righteous. That's righteous. So, you know, for the people that don't know, let's give them a little bit about what's going on with Dr. Whitaker and his consulting efforts. So, you know, I see that on the internets, you know what I'm saying? On the internets, they say that you are a diversity consultant, diversity and culture. So give us a little bit of an explaining of you know, what are you consulting about in diversity?
Yeah, no doubt. So Diamond Strategies is a diversity, equity, and inclusion firm. And we specialize in, we also do a lot of work in community relations, community engagement, but we specialize in making sure that environments in particular, organizations, institutions, environments, whether they be corporate, nonprofit, municipal, are as diverse and inclusive, and most importantly, as equitable as they can be. And equity is something that we emphasize quite intensely, because equity, if we were to select a synonym for that, would be justice or fairness. And that's often missed on people who are just concerned about putting bodies in seats, right? So we, you know, that is our work. This operationalized what I did at the university level for 19 years. You know, I was an instructor at Michigan State for 4 years while I was in graduate school, professor at ASU for 15 years. I am a historian, but within that area, I specialized in race, class, gender, civil and human rights. And when I left the university in 2016, I started Diamond Strategies to really operationalize what I was already doing. And that is getting out. I still, you know, do teaching informally, but to get out amongst people, particularly folks who hire and fire and teach our children and shape our public policy, hopefully to make some more just policies.
That's righteous. That's righteous. So, you know, it sounds like you are in the hero's work, good brother.
I'm just another cat in the struggle with you and everybody else, man. Just trying my best.
But it sounds like you're in the front lines, though, because this is a we definitely hear, you know, we're going to discuss some of the systematic issues at bay. But I definitely want to say this. It is been a burden of mine to be a part of that network of individuals who try to teach and instruct the population who need to be instructed on how to live on this planet, you know, how to share and how to be nice, you know, some things that I would have guessed, you know, you would have learned a long time ago, but instead you were being taught, you know, that the world is yours and the conquerors are yours and you are to emulate them. So I applaud your heroism for even being on the front line, because I left those lines. I didn't have the patience to continue teaching in that arena where, you know, you should have already picked this up, man.
Yeah, I feel you on that too. And sometimes I'm not the most patient person in the world. And sometimes I wonder. And that's why I'm actually in what I consider to be a transitional period in my life, where I'm focusing more on, you know, I'm still on the front lines in a lot of ways, particularly intellectually, right? Mm-hmm. And in terms of engaging people. but I'm not out on the street as much. You know, we got millennials and Zs to go out there and do that. But just the educational part with other adults, it's a struggle, man. It's a struggle. There's a lot of fear out there. There's a lot of hard-headed people. There's a lot of entitlement. Yeah. And I think the fear fuels the hatred.
Oh, yeah.
Jealousy fuels the hatred, right? Yeah. And that's the hardest part, man.
Yeah, absolutely. People
dig their heels in.
Yeah, yeah. So, you know, how much does your work, do you have to address, you know, traumas within the community? So if you got a organization that you're there, you know, you're informing them and empowering them with this information, and then the information stirs up something within, you know, our white brothers and sisters that causes them to have, you know, some sort of reaction, you know, verbally, physically, whatever. You know, does this happen in your courses?
Oh, without a doubt. And I have to tell you, when the pandemic hit, like many businesses, we were hit hard. Because we are people, right? So yeah, most of our clients and contracts were in person in nature. Okay. And so when the pandemic hit, quarantines were issued, all of our contracts were either suspended or canceled, all of them. Yeah. And so we quickly had to adjust to that. And DEI work, diversity, equity, and inclusion work is one of the first things to go. Right. Because it's often viewed as some kumbaya type of dependable stuff.
Professional development.
Professional, right.
And knock that right out.
Right. Among a lot of people, particularly leaders who think they get it already.
Okay.
Right.
Okay.
And so then George Floyd was martyred. Yeah. Breonna, or at least we found out, Breonna Taylor is martyred. Ahmaud Arbery, right? So many others. And the world changed because those millennials, those Zs, even I got out there, were putting it to people, right? I mean, throwing Confederate statues in rivers and taking over buildings and what have you, you know, striding in a way that folks hadn't been in a generation.
Yes.
And then all of these clients and a bevy of ones we hadn't worked with yet began to call us.
Okay.
And most of the calls were made by either Black women who worked within these organizations who had been trying to get something done already for years and were told no, right?
All right.
After that, it would be, you know, white women and the Latinas, right?
Yeah.
Calling.
Yeah.
I think one male manager, CEO, vice president of a company called.
Wow.
Two. And so, and what they were dealing with is exactly what you were talking about, trauma in the workplace, trauma in schools, trauma in organizations, Black folks not wanting to come to work, brown folks not wanting to come to work, going into the bathroom, those that were still going in, because, you know, we're overrepresented among essential staff. So a lot of us are still going into work, right?
Yeah.
They're crying in the bathroom on break. Their blood pressure's going up. The stress is going up. And so they, you know, these organizations had a sense of urgency that they hadn't had before. I dealt with one company where all of their Black employees on Zoom turned off their computers and walked off the job.
Ooh.
Virtually. and this constituted about a third of their workforce.
Wow.
And so people are feeling it in ways they hadn't before. And one of the things I love about this, not that people are suffering and struggling, you know, we're here to help them through that. But one of the things that I think, sometimes people come to lessons the hard way, like my grandmother used to say, is people, these organizations and institutions have realized the power that average people have.
Wow.
Even if you're an employee, collectively, they have a lot of power.
Yeah.
The problem is in the past, individually, I think people kind of felt like they were alone.
Yeah.
So, you know, we've dealt with smaller groups of Black folk and then the leaders of these organizations too.
Wow, man, that sounds like some real work that you got ahead of you right here, man. I'm excited to be having this conversation with you. You know, things are not necessarily the way a lot of people planned. I saw online one of the news articles put a post up of Breonna Taylor's Instagram, said 2020 was going to be her year. You know, this is an unexpected expectation. Like, it's not like this hasn't been in the back of our minds waiting for the catalyst for this this old Jim Crow spirit, this old I'm better than you, I'm a supremacist, and why are you still over in this part of the world, we did this, we created this without you, those ideals to resurface. And I'm telling you, I did not expect it at this point. I kind of thought it might sneak its head up years from now. We would have already had a system in place to deal with it, identify it and deal with it right away. But it seems that, this is the time that it's afforded us, good brother. We deal with it.
Yeah, no doubt about it. I think I was with you. I've been saying for years, people would ask me, when are things going to get better? When are we going to turn the corner on this? And I said, number one, it's going to get worse before it gets better. Mm. And number two, when it gets worse, when it gets bad, it's going to be really bad, right? And folks said, well, what does that mean? And I said, there's going to be violence. People are going to have to die. Because that is the history of this country.
Oh, yeah.
When you talk about change, I just told a group the other day, at no point in the history of this country, as the dominant population woke up one morning and said, we just need to do right by Black people, Indigenous people, poor folks. It just hasn't happened.
Yeah.
It hasn't happened. And so I knew that was going to happen. And then with the trigger for me, I gave a speech in Bristol, Tennessee, the spring of 2016. Okay. And someone asked me jokingly in a crowd, do you think Trump can win? Ha ha, laughing, everybody was looking at each other laughing. And I said, yes. And they all stopped and looked at me like, this dude is crazy.
Yeah.
And I said, yeah, he can win. And you know why? Precisely because of what you guys are doing right now. You think it's funny. You think it's a joke.
Yeah.
But you don't understand America. And, and I thought to myself, if it's going to happen, if the sea change is going to begin, once I realized he was going to win, I thought, and this was long before the election, I thought it's going to happen on his watch at some point.
Oh, yeah, yeah, man.
That's
really interesting. It makes me think about a quote from Pastor A.R. Bernard I heard years ago. At the roots of every human institution are the seeds of its own destruction, and at the roots of America are deception and violence and lies and discrimination based off of whatever, and that's what are lying at the roots of this country. And we need to dig up the roots. Otherwise, this is going to be the perpetual cycle. The blood in the streets is going to happen again 100 years from now. We're going to be, I thought about, the blessing of YouTube, how I saw these documentaries about what was going on 100 years ago. With the flu and the influenza pandemic, and there was race riots then. And I'm thinking to myself, man, we just are not getting out of this situation until we deal with the roots.
Yeah. And I talked about that too with some folks. Before the first case of COVID arrived, at least what we thought was the first case, I said to some folks, DEI people, right? Progressive, diversity, equity, inclusion people, I said, we need to start preparing to help our vulnerable communities, Black, Brown, Indigenous communities, poor communities, if this virus arrives, because we're going to die at a higher rate than everybody else. And another group, one of the folks in the group said, "Oh, you make everything about race. You even making this virus over there about race." And I said, "Everything has a racial effect." Yes. A gendered effect, right? Yes. An economic effect. And they don't want to hear it. And that's the issue.
Yeah.
Folks have not wanted to hear it for a long time. But what I think is fascinating is even one of the so-called founding fathers of the United States, Thomas Jefferson, told us when he was talking about slavery, he knew he was wrong. But he said, slavery is like holding a wolf by the ears. Eventually, it's going to get away from you. See, he knew what was going to happen, but he knew he'd be long dead when the reckoning came.
Yeah.
I'm just being real. And so.
Try to be a voice.
Right. And so here we are. And we have an opportunity to not kick the can down the road like we did in 1787, 1789, 1861, 1865, 1877. I can go on and on and on. Oh. We kept kicking down the can down the road. And that includes a small but influential number of us, Black folk.
Yeah.
Who bought into this idea of American exceptionalism, purity, and
that's going to happen, as if it was going to happen, as if it was going to be real, and I'm sure you've had to experience this idea of code switching. When I learned it, I think I learned that when I was in high school, that there was a behavior that I had to become accustomed to performing, in the presence of especially white people who were in authority at my school, especially. You know, I may have even talked a different language with the Black teachers or the coaches or whoever of color at the school than I did my interactions with these white teachers and white principals, because there was an expectation of this switching. I couldn't be myself. I couldn't be as loud or expressive. Or, I couldn't show anger, couldn't show any of that in that facility. I was muted in my emotions. And so to deal with that trauma within itself after the discovery of like, wait a minute, I've been held back, conditionally, I've been conditioned to hold myself back. It makes me think about, how the effects of this experiment are resonating even beyond me, into my children, into my grandchildren. And I don't want that.
No, I don't want it either. And it's funny, I just had a talk with my children. I have two adult children and two younger children. And I told them, I said, you know what? In the last 10 years, I like to think we're all constantly growing. Last 10 years, beginning when I was approaching my 40s, I said, you know what? I'm done code switching everywhere I go. Mm. That's inevitable. You're going to do a little bit of it. I said, but this is exhausting. And, it's exhausting. And I worked hard for whatever social, economic, and political things I have. But it's exhausting and it's fool's gold, because no one is perfect. No one can have multiple personalities and maintain a sense of balance and equilibrium, let alone happiness. And I told my kids, I said, listen, I was taught growing up by people who wanted me successful, not my mom, okay, but other, well, my mom was enlightened, but everybody else, you got to be twice as good. You got to work twice as hard. You got to be twice as articulate. You got to dress better. You have to, basically we have to be perfect.
We have to be perfect.
So at the same time that the world is telling us that we're far from perfect, in fact, we're quasi-human, we're also told that we have to be perfect to overcome that. And somewhere in between, we kill ourselves mentally, physically, and spiritually.
Thank you so much for that.
So for the rest of my life, whatever I attain or not attain, I'm going to be who I am as I'm doing it.
This is Soul Star Live. We're going to take a break right after this. Dr. Whitaker, take care. Black, welcome Black. Welcome back, Soul Star Live. I'm so excited, man. Now we're gonna jump into the nitty gritty. We done laid some of the peanut butter out, you know, on top of the bread. We done made it comfortable for them. And let's go ahead and put some of the crunch into the situation. You know, we're gonna talk about policing. And I wanted to ask you you're a historian. I'm glad I got you on the show. So if I start talking, they ain't gonna be like, yeah, that brother don't know what he's talking about. What kind of research he did? Give us really quickly, you know, and in whatever kind of way that you can, a breakdown of like the origins of policing, like why policing came to be, and, you know, kind of what was its initial design and what made it evolve into what it is today.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, so policing in the United States can be traced all the way back to colonial America, within which there were militia groups that were formed locally to protect villages and townships against outsiders. And some of those outsiders would have been folks from other colonies, people who worshiped differently, whatever the case may be. They were not designed necessarily indigenous people in particular, right? Incursions by indigenous people who wanted their land back or resources or wanted to be able to define the nature of the relations. But they were not created with the primary focus of the protecting the folks in the community from each other, right? It was to protect us from these other people. Now, if you fast forward past the 17th century, you start to see these become more organized as squads to capture escaped enslaved people and bring them back.
The Fugitive Slave Act.
Fugitive Slave Act, exactly. So these militias morphed into being the primary tool that was used to keep indigenous people and Black people and enslaved people in check. And so I say that simultaneously because, yes, the history is rooted in slave catchers, but it was also rooted in apprehending indigenous people and chasing them out into the so-called frontier. You saw the first big shift in 1838, Boston created the first formal police force that would look like something that we would identify as a police force in a rudimentary sense. But it was created for the Irish population to protect itself from white Anglo-Saxon Protestants who considered them to be the white so-called N-words. And that's exactly a phrase that was used to describe them.
The one in 1800s was for Irish to be protected against other European Anglo-Saxons.
Oh yeah. They because they were being discriminated and exploited by those white Anglo-Saxon Protestants. So they organized first with gangs, and then they professionalized and moved into policing, which was they considered to be a more healthy way of doing it to protect themselves from outsiders. And then you saw this happen in New York with Italians and Philly and Slavs. And then you start to see the professionalization of policing, uniforms in New York, right? In the Midwest and in San Francisco, when people of African descent were then free, or rather we freed ourselves and started to move in large numbers into these urban areas, then you see a corresponding explosion in police forces who were not just protecting themselves against other white people. Now the Irish and the Italians are becoming white. In fact, there's a book called How the Irish Became White. And there's a book called White on Arrival with Italians, right? So now they are in position to people of color, they are all white people, even though they don't get along with each other. But they have to build these police forces to control these Black folks who are moving to Baltimore, Philly, Chicago, New York, Pittsburgh, San Francisco, in larger numbers in the areas that they used to, the Italians, Slavs, Germans, and Italians used to occupy.
Was that all we was doing was moving in? I just wanted to ask, was all we were doing just trying to occupy? We just wanted some place to stay.
We were moving in and we wanted jobs and land. But jobs and land in America, since about 1662, were made synonymous by white people with freedom and Americanness. And so you don't want to compete, and you can't remain the ideal of America if Black and brown people have what you have, which is land and jobs and economic standing. And then they used the fear of Black people raping white women as another excuse to sick law enforcement on us, to keep us in place. Because many of the race riots that exploded in 1917, 1918, 1919, right? The police officers were right in the middle of all of that.
Wow.
They were used as an apparatus of the state to basically put us back in our place. But here's the thing. They were also used to put broke white people back in their place, too. So we know Andrew Carnegie, for instance, used his own private police force, picketed detectives, and what would now be police to keep Slavs in his villages that he owned. Because, you know, Carnegie owned the houses that these people lived in. He owned the stores that they shopped at. He owned everything. And when they tried to escape and fight back, his Pinkertons killed a bunch of them. So the thing about the relationship between police and communities, and especially communities of color, it's not broken. There's never been one. There's never been a healthy relationship.
Come on now. Come on now.
And so this whole language needs to stop, because we're talking about an institution that was built from the earliest stages to keep outsiders from getting in to white power, privilege, and control.
Wow.
And you know, and so we have to think about that. You know, people, we have to know that.
Yeah. And so in that journey, when did the transition? So like right now, right now, the Chicago police union had been under like negotiations. Their contract, you know, is still in the air, but their presence is there. When did it become such a force? When did policing become such a force that, you know, the government would have to call the National Guard to do something about the city because the police might not be? When did that become like a thing of the norm?
Yeah. Two individuals, and I'm forgetting their names right now, Midwest, one in San Francisco, are primarily responsible for the professionalization of police. And one of the things that they did, in addition to uniforms, was begin what became an academy to train them, defense tactics, weaponry, how to communicate with citizens, right? What one of them also did was begin the unionization movement, right? And from the earliest stages, that unionization started to cause problems. Even many people in white communities were concerned, because the unions then, their first responsibility, and at least in practice, what was demonstrated was that their first priority was protecting themselves rather than the citizens. And so, you know, what was created is, in a lot of areas, were community citizen review boards.
Yeah,
that's not new.
We'll
talk about those things like we're just talking about some new stuff, and it's not new at all. But it's always been controversial, because like Frederick Douglass said, power can seize nothing without demand. Once you create a union like that that started to have deep pockets and this fraternal, you know, bleed blue type of thing rather than protect your citizens first, then we started to have a problem.
Okay.
Then we started to have a problem, and it started to morph out of control. And you know, and I know a lot of police officers on the inside that'll tell you this.
Yeah.
You know? So it's largely unchecked. And the policies that would come then, because the unions would pay a lot of money to influence political folks to introduce public policies that would protect them, like qualified immunity.
There you go. So when the current sitting commander in chief says to the gentleman trying to get the seat, I have the backing.
Isn't that a trip?
You know, yeah, I mean, that was
for the whole world. Yeah, I got the backing.
He put his cards on the table, bro. Hey, bro, look what I got. You want to check my deck? He ready to shut the game down with that statement alone. Like, look who I can call on.
And they did, but see, this is the definition of institutional racism. What people don't understand is when you start creating these unions and they become corrupt and primarily concerned about the longevity of each other and not taking care of us, right? Yeah. That changes the whole dynamic of what's going on the inside, you know? And so then their first possibility or thought is to protect each other.
Yeah, to protect each other and to be incentivized for their work, which is something that, you know, I would definitely, you know, if I had more time, I would definitely talk about. If you want to put incentivization on anybody's job, it needs to be these teachers. You know, incentivize a teacher for having students complete all 12 grades, but don't incentivize these officers for pulling me over for going through a speed trap. Now that is inappropriate and irresponsible, but you know, I'm only me. I'm gonna just say my little piece and get it in. We're gonna take a quick little break. We're gonna take a little synopsis here. We thank y'all so much for listening in. If you're tuning in on YouTube, thank you so much. Make sure you like and subscribe. And if you're tuning in on Radio Phoenix, keep going with there. Make sure you share that link as well. We're about to have a good time and wrap this little conversation up on the radio. But we, you know, we'll invite you also to come on to the YouTube, the Soul Star Live YouTube, to check out the after show, because Dr. Whitaker and I, we're going to have a little conversation about self-care and what to do about these police brutality situations that might be stuck in our head right there, I'm telling you. So do you know that there's still time until October 31st to fill out the census? Don't forget to respond and make sure to count all kids and babies living with you most of the year, even if you aren't family members. The census counts everyone. And it only takes a few minutes so that local schools and programs get more federal funding that they need for the next 10 years. Big or small, the census is for us all. Fill out the census today at my2020census.gov. That's my2020census.gov. Or call 844-330-2020. There'll be more Soul Star Live right after this break. Conversation for us to have here with Dr. Whitaker, Dr. Matthew Whitaker, the owner and creator of the Whitaker Group. Thank you so much for being on Soul Star Live. I just want to make sure that we get our gratitudes out. And I want you, before we jump back into the dialogue, because I got more questions about this organization here
that's no doubt
terrorizing us for years. The Stono Institute for Freedom, Justice, and Security. Dr. Whitaker, can you give us a breakdown about what that is and where people can get more information?
Yeah, the Stono Institute for Freedom, Justice, and Security is a new nonprofit, 501c3, created out of Florida. I am a founding board member of that organization, and a good friend of mine who was a distinguished professor of international studies and a director of a program at Florida A&M University is the founding executive director.
Hello, baby.
Oh, you hear the baby?
Yeah, it's all right. Oh. It's all right, brother. It's all right. Hey, brother, this we zooming right now, bro.
It's the new reality.
It's the new reality. What's the baby name?
Royal.
Royal. All right on, right on. We shout out.
Real 7 weeks old.
7 weeks. Yeah. Oh,
I'm surprised that my 5-year-old Ronan hasn't run past me behind me.
That's all right, no brother. That's all right.
Yeah, yeah. Oh man. All right. Where do you want me to pick up, man?
So at the Stoner, like give us some information about this organization. Yeah, yeah. And the event that's coming up as well.
Yeah. So we're going to be having an event, the Stoner Institute. It's a webinar. It's going to take place this Wednesday, October 7th, 6:30 to 8:30 p.m. Eastern. Some quality guests, Dr. Jeremy Levitt, who I was mentioning early, is going to facilitate. Dr. Carol Boyce Davies, who was one of the leading Africana studies professors and scholars and activists in the world. She's from the Caribbean originally, will be on. Ricky Jones, Dr. Ricky Jones, who is the director of the Pan-African Studies Department, University of Louisville, will be on. He's in Louisville, so he has a bird's eye view of a lot of what's going on in Louisville right now. So if people have, you know, questions and what have you, he's great. Morehouse graduate. And then we got Pastor Roderick Zack, who is one of the leading pastors in Florida, who's been working in this area a long time. The Stoner Institute does a lot of different things. One of them is working with law enforcement on racial bias, the racial animus, testing to start to implement this before folks come in. And we also believe in holding people accountable. So we have filed, the organization has filed a claim in an international human rights court against the United States for human rights violations of people of African descent in particular, particularly at the hands of violent white extremists. And so we invite people to tune in, become a part of the movement. We have several other programs. We have Know Your Rights. We have a Understand Gun Laws, Gun Safety. There's somebody who, Dr. Levitt, actually teaches a gun safety class for people of African descent. So I encourage people, it's a good antidote to some of the kumbaya messages that we're getting out there among folks about how we can respond to this. We advocate nonviolence, so I don't want to give people the wrong idea, but what we do want to do is empower people in every way, shape, or form.
Thank you for going in on my behalf, because I wouldn't have been able to bring any petitions up, you know. So I'm, you know, as a person who might have to fall under the identification as a Black or a African American that has suffered, you know, either by proxy or indirectly from this this kind of treatment. Now, I appreciate that, man. That sounds like, you know, there's a lot of times, you know, we the people, you know, the ones that you know are on the low man on the totem pole. We feel like ideas, but I don't really have the access or the resources to be able to do it. And that makes me feel real good that, you know, the people that have the access and the resources and the ideas and the language to go and present this, you know, on a world stage on our behalf. Yo, shout out to you, big brother, man. I'm serious. That's what's up. I
appreciate it. No problem. Man.
So let's jump back in for the last couple of minutes. We got like 56. We got a couple minutes, 56 seconds or 30 seconds, 20 minutes, couple seconds, 20 seconds. I'm sorry, minutes, not minutes.
I got you.
Time is running nigh. But I want to bring in the local conversation really quickly before we run out on the radio station. How do we kind of present some of this information about expectations and reforms and changes, you know, locally here in the Valley?
Yeah, we have to ensure that our communities, that we take the bull by the horn and make sure that they're educated about what's actually going on here, how deadly it is, right? How all of us are but a moment away from becoming a statistic, because we're dealing with a large institution with deep pockets who's primarily worried about preserving itself and not protecting us. We have to understand the hierarchy. We have to understand that the mayor has very little power with regard to police. We have to understand that the police chief answers to the assistant city manager. The assistant city manager answers to the city manager. The city manager answers to city council. City manager and assistant city manager hire the police chief. That's the chain. So we need to know who we need to be sending our emails to and sending our phone calls to. We have to understand also that the unions are not always in concert with the brass and the leadership. And the unions have deep pockets. The unions are the ones that almost uniformly will protect police officers, even the ones that are doing bad stuff. Because in their minds, they are the last line between vulnerable police officers who harm somebody, accidentally or without any malice, right? Yeah. Being taken out. And so as a consequence, they're overcompensating and protecting everybody. And even pushing through paid relationships with politicians, policies like qualified immunity, which says that you can't even prosecute some police when they're executing their duties. So in other words,
why can't you do it? So why qualified immunity stops us from prosecuting them?
Well, qualified immunity means that if a police officer in the execution of their duties kills one of us, there's provisions that say that they cannot be criminally prosecuted for executing their duties. They're basically shielded from accountability.
Because killing us is a part of their duties, if necessary, or something like that. At some point, taking a life would have been a part of job responsibilities on day one.
Well, this is how I put it to people. It effectively legalizes our murder at the hands of police officers. And the argument is we need qualified immunity so just angry, disgruntled people aren't taking us out at the drop of the hat. Right? Mm. So we have to look at that. But see, oftentimes our communities don't know where to look. Yeah. What we know is, well, we got a mayor and we got a, you need to start council, city manager, assistant city manager, police chief, and understand the police chief and city manager's office don't always agree with the unions. But they have to, in some ways, placate the unions, because the unions got to have a lot of money, a lot of clout. People donate to them, right? They have a lot of political clout. And as we've seen this at the recent debate. So we have to take this we have to wrestle back our control over these public servants.
That's righteous. That's righteous, good brother. I appreciate that, man. I appreciate that. We gotta end the show and wrap up. I want to say thank you so much to our guest, Dr. Matthew Whitaker of the Whitaker Group. This is Soul Star Live. I'm your host, Calvin Worthen. Soul Star Live is a production of Desert Soul Media Incorporated. Our executive producer is Kaja Brown. For more information about what we're doing here in the Valley, you want to go to desertsoulmedia.org. If you want some more of our archive shows, go to soulstarlive.com. Thank you so much for listening in.
Stay tuned
for the after show right here on YouTube. Soul Star Live is out. Great night.